I am presenting you is a paper on the adventures of Vergesellschaften. I apologize for the pronunciation of my German, which very often is probably awful. As you know, Vergesellschaftung is a German word for socialization. Socialization has been actually at the heart of the present debate on Marx since some decades, I would say. In the talk I am giving to you, I will concentrate on some positions. I actually begin from a German author and an Italian author. The German author is one of the most well-known German Marxian theorists today, is Michael Heinrich. My reference would be to his book in German, Wissenschaft vom Wert, The Science of Value, which has been published in the first edition in 1991 and in the second revised edition in 1999. It should be out in English next year. The second author is an Italian author. I have been in discussion with him. Sometimes I even wrote with him. It's an Hegelian philosopher, Roberto Finelli. Roberto Finelli has written at least three important books on Marx. The best one in my view is the one of 1987, but it has not been translated in English. Then he has written a book on the young Marx and Hegel, and a third book on the mature Marx and Hegel. The second book has been already translated in English. I am confident that the third book will be translated in English. The second book on the young Marx was published in Italian in 2004 and translated last year in English. I think that the title was A Failed Parasite. The last book is The Accomplished Parasite, about the old Marx. These are the two positions on socialization that I will argue about. For Michael Heinrich, abstract labor is actually a nachträgliche Vergesellschaftung, is the result of an a posteriori socialization on the commodity market, that is, in circulation. Abstract labor as value comes into existence only in circulation, when the private labors, the products of private labors, are exchanged with money as universal equivalent, which validates them socially. And this money is just a symbol. Michael Heinrich defines this theory, that this Marx theory, that he is revising a monetary theory of value. Of course, this could not but interest me, because in 1989, the Italian version is before, I wrote an article which was published in the Review of Radical Political Economics, and the title was A Monetary Labor Theory of Value. I never divorced the dimension of money from the dimension of value. In the case of Roberto Finelli, we have, so to speak, the negative of this position, an opposite position. For Roberto Finelli, labor in capitalist production, already in capitalist production, is immediately social. In Italia is immediatamente sociale. This socialization, which is already there in production, is accomplished through technology. We have to go into this category of technology to understand this argument. Roberto Finelli says, abstract labor as the labor socialized in production through capitalist technology is actually nothing but labor which is devoid of any concrete property. Debate, I think that we have to go back to the origin of this so-called Neue Marx Lektüre, the new reading of Marx. The new reading of Marx was proposed in the late 60s and early 70s by pupils of Adorno. I am referring especially to Helmut Reichelt and to Hans-Georg Backhaus. Their thinking begins from actually Adorno and Horkheimer. And so, actually, in my exposition, I will begin with Adorno and Horkheimer, and then go to this first generation debate in the Neue Marx Lektüre with Reichelt and Backhaus. I will detect some problematic points which relates to the relationship between abstract labor, exchange and production. I will see how Michael Heinrich and Roberto Finelli try to resolve the problems in this debate and in the way the Marxian theory of value was read. And I will try to find a way of my own to sublate, so to speak, this debate. And I will refer to especially three authors. One is Isaac Ilich Rubin, the essays of Marx, Marx and Value Theory. The second is an Italian economist, Claudio Napoleoni. I studied with him in the early 70s. The third one is another Italian economist, Augusto Graziani. Augusto Graziani, in my view, proposed a class macro monetary theory of capitalist production, though he didn't go too much into the subtleties of the labor theory of value, and though I'm sure that would be very much nervous about most of what I will say to you about the philosophical aspects of Marx and so on, I think that his approach is crucial to introduce a third notion of socialization after the a posteriori socialization of the market and after the socialization in production. He introduced a third notion of socialization, which is an ex-ante socialization at the beginning of the cycle of money capital. This is what I will more or less try to impose to you. Let us begin with some quotes from Adorno. This is, of course, Teddy, the Wieselgrund Adorno. I take a couple of quotes from the Negative Dialectics, where Adorno writes that the objectivity of historic life is that of natural history. Marx, as opposed to Hegel, knew this, that the objectivity of historic life was that of natural history. So to speak, the objectivity of societies, we will say in capitalism, is a second nature. But this was already known to Hegel, but Marx was opposed to Hegel because he put this argument in the context of the universal that is realized over the subject's heads. The quote ends a few lines after in this way: Hegel made do with a personified transcendental subject. Marx denounced not just the Hegelian transfiguration, but the state of fact it occurs. So the point is that the universal that is realized over the subject as this second nature, which is actually perceived and going on as the first nature, in Hegel was personified in a transcendental subject, so to speak, spirit, the Geist. Marx, especially Major Marx, does not just denounce the idealism of this Hegelian transfiguration, but denounce the state of fact from which this idealism is presented in reality. So in fact, reality is, so to speak, an idealist reality, as we will say in a minute. Already Adorno, in this writing of the 60s, referred to Vergesellschaftung, socialization. If you go to the book or lectures, Introduction to Sociology, in the first pages you find this quote: when we speak of society in the strong sense, we are referring essentially to the element of Vergesellschaftung, socialization. This kind of socialization does not apply to other societies. So this socialization is specifically capitalist. It is a functional connection which leaves no one out. It is a totality, it is a whole, it is a connectedness in which all the members of the society are entwined, and which takes this socialization a certain kind of autonomy in relation to them. Society has been made autonomous, and it is no longer intelligible. This is actually the criticism of Adorno relatively to Popper. It is only society below of becoming autonomous. This last quote in the slide is exactly from the introduction of the book about the positivist dispute, the debate with Adorno. I want to recognize to my younger friend and co-author Tommaso Redolfi Riva the merit of having presented me, put to my attention these Adorno's thinking. I will, even though probably Tommaso would not follow me in all down the line of what I'm saying, I would like to put this Adorno's position in relation to the fundamental distinction, in my view, of fetish character and fetishism. I will come back to this point in the lecture of tomorrow. The two things are not the same, and I will explain why in a minute. If we look at what Adorno says, says, Adorno says that the exchange as a process is, as I told you, the specific capitalist form in which Vergesellschaftung happens. Society, as we saw in the quotes, is a totality, which is the domination of the universal over the particular. The implication for Adorno is that this social reality is conceptual. There is a conceptuality in the exchange, and it is the exchange, says Adorno, which generates value. So value is immaterial. At the same time, it is a real abstraction. Adorno, more than Horkheimer actually, was in dialogue with Zone Rethel. I will come back on this notion of real abstraction later. It is an abstraction going on in practice in the exchange process. The problem with this real abstraction is that this process of abstraction is obliterating, so to speak, its traces. So this real abstraction is a mystifying reality. It is, of course, we have in front of us society as the domination over the universal, over the particular, but this whole is not the truth, as Hegel said. The famous phrase by Adorno is the whole, meaning the exchange, society as a market, is the false. Since we have this accomplished, finished form of society in front of us, what sociological thinking needs to do is to go deep into what Adorno calls the anamnesis of the genesis. It must recollect behind this finished thing-like reality, what constituted it in a human practice. Why I refer to the fetish character and fetishism? Because, put in this way, the argument is that society in capitalism, as a generalized market society, has become a fetish. What is a fetish? It is a regulating social power delegated, so to speak, to the objects, but the social power of the objects is real, it is not fake. Objects really have that social power. They have that power in the specific capitalist social relations. And the social power acts behind the back of the agents. This originates fetishismus, which is a quite different thing. Fetishismus is to attribute the social power of the things to the things not in the capitalist social relation, but to the things as natural objects themselves. It is this naturalization fetishismus. Let us move to Max Horkheimer. Max Horkheimer is the one on the left. I arrived to Max Horkheimer passing through the guy on the right. He has been very influential in my thinking for his writing of the 60s and early 70s. I was formed in the early 70s, actually, in reading Marx. The guy on the right is Alfred Schmidt. Okay. I do something. Alfred Schmidt.
Sorry, give me a second. It's going on and on to the absurd.
Okay, sorry. The Schmidt. Who was Alfred Schmidt? Alfred Schmidt was a pupil of Horkheimer and Adorno. I would say a pupil first of all of Horkheimer and then of Adorno. He wrote his dissertation with both the leaders of the Frankfurt School in 1957 to 1960. The dissertation became his book in 1962, The Concept of Nature in Marx. But here I am actually insisting on his paper of 1967, which is 50 years ago, and of course it was the centenary of the publication of the first book of Capital. Here, Alfred Schmidt wrote a fundamental paper on the key role in the critique of political economy of the notion of Darstellung. Darstellung is can be translated as exposition, also as presentation. I will sometime use the term exhibition. Actually, Alfred Schmidt used very heavily this concept also in his important book translated in English later on. The book is of 72, History and Structure. This notion he took from Max Horkheimer, the writings of Max Horkheimer in the 30s. The reference is especially to the essay on traditional theory versus critical theory. It does not move anymore.
No, it's probably only...
Let me try to be quick instead and beyond the difficulties of techniques. The point is that Horkheimer made a distinction between inquiry, forschung, and presentation, exposition, exhibition, Darstellung. The beginning of the discourse of Marx are the finished forms, the facts, so to speak. But these finished forms are historical social products. They are a second nature, disguising itself as a sort of first nature, but the point is that you can produce a critique of the second nature only, this was Horkheimer's point, from the point of view of its possible transformation. So the movement of the Darstellung was linked to the idea of Marx materialism as a practical materialism. You have to go back to the book of 62, The Concept of Nature in Marx, to understand better what I am saying. Historical laws, and here we are again in a Marx Horkheimer thesis, are not an a priori construction, a sort of essentialism, but they are not just a registration of mere facts by an independent gnoseological subject, what probably this tradition would call empiricism. Hegel actually was providing already in the introduction to the phenomenology, the preface, and the science of logic, a way out from this duality. The conclusion by Alfred Schmidt from Max Horkheimer is, however, that when the capitalist product relations are established, that is when history has produced, not necessarily, not technologically, but has ended up into the production relations, then we have in front of us a system. The system is autonomous, the Adorno scheme, can be explained in its own logic as something positing its own presupposition. So We have a society which is exhibited as super historical, sort of natural, but it has historical origin. This society is a process without subject. The expression by Althusser is absolutely right, but this cannot be hypostasized into a methodical truth valid forever. This is what is happening in this society. This is the truth of the society, which is the false, according to the Adorno's line. So we must make this history, prehistory, with a possible transformation beyond capitalism. If you take this line, as Alfred Schmidt did, Hegel's logic was, so to speak, the philosophical counterpart of the ontology of value which grows upon itself as capital. So, as actually Schmidt says in his book History and Structure, dialectics, dialectical method, has just an historically local validity. This method works only for the social reality of capitalism. And once capitalism will be overcome, the dialectical method will be revoked. Now, my point is that maybe Alfred Schmidt, that was a pupil of Adorno, but also Helmut Reichel, Adorno and Durkheim, but also Helmut Reichel, who did his dissertation with both, and Hans-Georg Backhaus, who again was in the Adorno seminar, these three young people may be responsible of the fact that in the 60s Adorno himself went back to this notion of society as I express it to you. I know for sure, because this is said by Reichert, that he and Backhaus went to talk with Horkheimer and Adorno on this stuff. Horkheimer seemed not to remember what he was writing in the past. Adorno didn't get very much their point, the point of Reichert and Backhaus. What was the point of Reichert and Backhaus? This is Helmut Reichert. The point of Reichert and Backhaus is to shift the problematic of Adorno from the formation of categories in sociology to the formation of categories in political economy, so to provide the basis of a critique of political economy. To do this, the idea of Reichert and Backhaus was that you had to shift the discourse from where ended with Adorno, exchange, to the category of money. The point of Reichert was that in a generalized market society, all these authors think that the generalized market society is capitalism. They don't believe in the simple commodity society or something like that. They don't believe in the Engels interpretation. They think that this market society is an objectified conceptuality. But this objectified conceptuality, this is the move forward relative to Adorno, is embedded in money. Money as the exterior form of value. When you move the problematic of Adorno in these territories, the problem becomes to reconstruct the genesis of money. And then what the two authors did, Reichert and Backhaus, in different but related ways. They both looked and at Marx's writings before the second edition of Capital. Backhaus, by chance, discovered in the mid-60s the first edition of Capital. In the first edition of Capital, the first chapter is very different, much more dialectical. The Grundrisse were having finally a diffusion in the 60s. So these two authors concentrated on the prehistory of Das Kapital, second edition, from the Grundrisse to the first edition of Das Kapital, because in these writings the categories of contradiction, doubling, form of value are more at the forefront. The question is, I told you, reconstruct the genesis of money. And to reconstruct the genesis of money, you have to pursue a dialectical derivation. How the inner duality within the commodity between use value and value develops into the external duality, and so the arising of money as an autonomous entity. At this point you arrive in Marx to the category of money as money, and from money as money you have to provide a transition to money as capital. This is actually what very much in detail, working especially but not only on the Grundrisse and the Urtext, Helmut Reichert did in his book, and the title of his book was Zur Logischen, or Logischen, I don't know, Struktur des Kapital Begriffs by Karl Marx, the logical structure of the concept of capital in Karl Marx. Lucio Colletti at the time was an admirer of Schmidt and Reichert. He was asked to do an introduction to Italian translation. The book was immediately translated in 72. He refused. He said he liked the book, but he made a critical observation which I think is right. And the observation is the title is not actually faithful to the book, because the book practically in its entirety, except for the last few pages, is just on the logical structure of commodity and money. Never reaches capital, properly speaking, except for the few last pages on the transition of money to capital. It is one of my arguments that this is the cars, la maledizione, I hope, to understand of the Neue Marx lecture. They stop very much in the first three or four chapters of Das Kapital. Going back to the development of Reichert's theory, Reichert's position, his insistence is that value theory is the theory of money, not only the theory of exchange, the theory of money. More specifically, it is the theory of the forms of money. So it goes very much in detail in the transition from the price form, which has to do with money as measure of value, to the distinction between money and currency, Geld and Münze, which is in the part of means of circulation. This distinction between Geld and Münze is crucial, but it is lost in most of the debate on Marx and Marx and money. Then he goes to money as money, especially ordering and means of payment, and then world money. Even though he writes about the writings before Marx's second edition, Das Kapital, you know that these are the topics of the first three chapters of Marx's Das Kapital. Reichert very much insists on the point that I raised talking of Alfred Schmidt, the fact that dialectics is not a universal method. It is a method of withdrawal, a method of recall. It is the method of Widerruf. Why? Because Hegel's idealism, this is a quote, is nothing but bourgeois society as ontology. It is the philosophical doubling of a real inversion, where a derived reality value in the commodity becomes the first, and he goes all this line and arriving to the strong argument that there is a fundamental identity of Marx, Capital, and Hegel's Geist. The dialectical method and the Hegelian presentation are one and the same. This point, paradoxically enough, was the reason why Lucio Colletti very much appreciated Helmut Reiner. You know that Lucio Colletti was born as an anti-Hegelian, he died as an anti-Hegelian, he came from De La Volpe, but after 67 he developed a new reading of value theory, based on the movement from the theory of alienation to the theory of fetishism. And this theory of fetishism is he very soon realizes is very much related to the theory of contradiction. And if you go to the last chapter of Marxism and Hegel, which is translated in English, he arrives exactly at the same conclusion of Helmut Reiner. The book of Colletti is 69, the book of the dissertation of Reichert is 70, published 72. This is the other guy of the earlier Neue Marxlektüre, Hans-Georg Backhaus, the one who discovered this first edition of Capital, the first chapter in the first edition, and wrote a seminal article, Dialectic of the Value Form, I think it was 69. Then he started working on his reading of Marx. There is a continuity between Reichert and Backhaus on many, if not all, the points. They agree on the fact that the Marxian theory of value is at the same time a theory of money. They provided, even much more than Alfred Schmidt, a purely logical reading of Das Kapital. The specificity of Backhaus, it was somehow hinted by Reicher, but not with the same force, and is this one, that Marx's monetary theory of value is against all other economic theories before and after him, because all the other theories of value are pre-monetary theories. This is true of classical political economy, this is true of neoclassical political economy, this is true of Marxist reading Capital. They have a notion of value which is pre-monetary. What Backhaus wanted to do at the beginning was to go back to a pure unaltered Marx, which was not understood by Engels and by the Marxists. So he began this series of essays, Material and Durbert Theorie, I think, Materials on Value Theory, and this is the line of his article, The Dialectic of the Value Form, then the first installment of the Material, the second installment of the Material, then there was a third and a fourth installment. But the third installment, this is one of the reasons why I like very much people like him, is that he said, I made an incredible mistake. The ambiguities and ambivalences are there in Marx. So it is not just that Engels misunderstood Marx. We have to go with Marx against Marx. And I am completely on this line, even more probably than Backhaus. He starts as Reichert from Adorno. He starts with the idea that the categories of economic theory are real abstractions. Real abstractions means forms of thought which are made objective and are expression of social determinations of existence. Categories of economic theory are subjective, objective notions. They are a subjective, objective unity. What does it mean? They are phenomenal forms of Adorno's super-individual socio-economic unity of thought and being. Subjective because they refer to labor. Objective because they refer to money and capital. To understand this, you must begin, as Reichert did, following Marx, from the commodity. The commodity is dual. It is a sensuous, supersensible entity. Sensuous because it is a use value. Supersensible value. But in the commodity, when you take a use value as a commodity, you don't touch value. So it is super sensible. A commodity really becomes a commodity only when the super sensible is made sensuous. Otherwise, the commodity is just a use value, and just a use value is not a commodity. To be a commodity, you must be sold against money and, in Marx's argument, in Reichert's argument, in Backhaus' argument, into another commodity. This value must be made sensuous is another commodity. What is this? A transubstantiation. This is the expression of Marx, and Backhaus takes this. This is an incarnation. They are, of course, theological, religious references. The point of this literature, and I am completely on that line, that they are not metaphors. They are scientific categories. Backhaus says, when this supersensible is exhibited in another commodity, we have the necessary manifestation of the essence, the necessary phenomenological manifestation of the essence. In German, this is an Erscheinung. The essence must appear, but this appearance is phenomenal manifestation. If I just take the superficial, what I see, the superficial reality, that is just a shine, an illusion, if I don't trace it back to the essence within the exposition. If I trace it back, the same superficial reality, to the inner essence, that is a shining. It is a phenomenal manifestation. We all know that for this Hegelian line, the essence must manifest itself. The point of Backhaus, and this is in a sense another of his novelties, is that this manifestation, however, even though it is not an illusion, a shine, even when we have reconstructed the whole, it is, however, a perverted, displaced, and crazy manifestation of the essential laws. These forms, commodity, value, and capital, they are ferrupte form. So the essence itself manifests as a mystification. Reality itself is mystified. Reality itself is paradoxical. again a non-Hegelian author, like originally non-Hegelian author, and later non-Hegelian author, like Coletti, arrived exactly on the same point, on the same page. And the page was Marx criticizing Samuel Bailey, better, making a critique of Samuel Bailey. What is in front of us is already from the beginning of Capital Volume 1, the first three chapters, the exchange value has not yet developed, but that exchange value is already a mystification of reality. It is mystical and paradoxical because it is a fetish. You know that the criticism of the serious economists like Joe Robinson and Gunnar Myrdal is value is a mystical category. This is meant as a criticism. Marx agrees with them, exactly. He agrees with them. Another quote from Lucio Coletti. This is because of the fetish. We have in front of us an objectivity which is objectualized and taken alone is a semblance. It has a semblance of naturality of social forms. So we have a reification, and if we stop to the superficial reality, we lose the processual genesis, and we are in the world of fetishism. In my reading, this distinction, fetish character, fetishism, is crucial. What is the duty of critical thinking, according to Hans-Georg Backhaus? The duty of critical thinking is to discover the human basis of the fetish, in my language. Then you have all the part on what is the monetary theory of value, to borrow the phrase from Heinrich in Hans-Georg Backhaus. That Marx is a monetary theory of value is already clearly there in Backhaus. Backhaus says, look, all the beginning of Capital in the first chapter shows that an exchange of pre-monetary commodities is not even thinkable. Classical and neoclassical theorists who see in the exchange an exchange of use values or of utilities, they are trying to express something which is not there, which is not even thinkable. Backhaus, however, says something really intriguing, because he said, well, but what about absolute value? Most of the younger authors in the Neue Marx-Lektüre line, and Heinrich is one of them, would say absolute value does not exist in Marx. Value is only a relational category. Value is there in one commodity, exchange with another commodity, is in the final commodity exchange in situation. But probably Backhaus has likely realized that at the beginning of Capital, Marx poses, third page, the question, but what about absolute value? And he says, it may seem, it is a semblance, that absolute value is not there. But absolute value is there. Is there before final exchange, in the commodity. And how is that possible? Well, in the fourth rag, I think it is preface or the introduction to the collection of his papers in 1997, which has the same title than the first article, The Dialectic of the Value Form, Hans-Georg Backhaus goes into this. He says, look, in the case of Marx, there exists a pre-monetary absolute value. But he's not falling into the problems of the other economic theories. The Marx pre-monetary absolute value is manifested not, like in classical and neoclassical, in a pre-monetary exchange value. It is expressed in a monetary structure, the duality of commodity and money. But what impressed me when I read it was the fact that Backhaus insists that this pre-monetary character of absolute value is extremely real. We are talking of an author who is saying the pre-monetary theory's value are wrong, and then he has absolute value, which has a pre-monetary character, and says, look, this is important. This is crucial in Marx. This is extremely real. I will give you the real quotation at the end, if I arrive there. But what he says in this preface to his book is that Marx's absolute value is the ens realissimum. Ens realissimum is a category from the scholastics. The ens realissimum in Adorno's meaning. It is the motor of the dialectical development, which is realized only in the movement of capital towards market. We take this quote, we put it aside with a gigantic question mark, and we will ask ourselves, at the end of my discourse, about what Hans-Georg Backhaus is talking. And now we move from these papers, which are books and papers, from early 70s, Weigert, papers of late 60s, early 80s, Backhaus. I published an Italian translation of the key papers of Backhaus. We move to the book of Michael Eirich. Michael Eirich is, I think, one of the most exciting authors in Marxian theory today. I will provide many criticisms, or many, they are meant as a critique of his position. But I really like this guy. As I told you, his book is The Science of Value. A key chapter is chapter 6. The title is A Monetary Theory of Value. My title in 1989 was A Monetary Labor Theory of Value. The difference is relevant. Eirich is within the Neue Marx Lectüre. He knows the derivation from Weigert and Backhaus. He, however, takes some distance from Backhaus and Weigert. He calls this line Hegel-Marxismus, and he does not accept what this Hegel-Marxismus says. He does not accept the position according to which Hegel's argumentative figures are the decisive key for understanding Marx's critique of political economy, and Eirich does not agree with this Hegel-Marxismus of Backhaus and Reichert when they say that one must first understand Hegel before one can understand Marx. My personal position is that, yes, Hegel-Marxismus is right in regarding Hegel's argumentative figures as the decisive key for understanding Marx's critique of political economy. However, I agree with Heinrich, and I think that it is not needed to first understand Hegel before one can understand Marx. Of course, it would be better, you know. But the real point is that the way Marx read Hegel was very idiosyncratic. If we look at all the literature on Hegel, at least from the 70s onwards, you can mount a powerful argument according to which Marx did not understand Hegel and made against Hegel charges which are not sensible. At the same time, my reading of Marx is that he saw exactly in the wrong features of the Hegelian system that he was criticizing, the features that corresponds to capitalist reality. So I'm not saying the Hegel I will talk to you about is fake. It will be a long discussion. What I'm saying is, even if Marx Hegel was fake, it is the relevant Hegel to read Marx Capital. You see what I am going to. And I could go into more paradoxes. If you take this line, you may say, oh, well, maybe Hegel was not that crazy idealist, was a kind of sensible and articulated realist. The words for him, because it would have been really the crazy idealist Marx is talking about, he would have a wonderful place in the history of philosophy together with the history of society, because his philosophy would be what Reichert said before, the ideological doubling of bourgeois society. Okay, let us leave aside the last slide. Let us look at the monetary theory of value of Megan Heinrich. He remains within what I called the course of the Neue Marxist theory. The derivation of money comes from simple circulation. He, of course, agrees that simple circulation is already capitalist to this reality. You know, it's not the simple commodity society. But it is from there that money is deduced. The argument by Heinrich is very much based on the first edition. He does not follow Backhaus and Reichert in saying that the second edition was already bad in Marx. All that was good was, I'm forcing the argument, but all that was good was before the second edition. Heinrich says that there has been continuous refinement. So you can say that what comes after is worse than what was before. But on the derivation of money, the point of Michael Heinrich is that the first edition was better. And the first edition was better because in the first chapter, Marx develops the forms of value and ends with the form 4, which is the universal equivalent, but it is not already money. In the first chapter, you have the structural, so to speak, objective constraints of a market society. A sort of macro social foundation, qualitative, only qualitative form determination. And this gives you the universal equivalent. When you go into the second chapter of the second edition, you are analyzing not the forms of value, but the process of exchange through the real subjects, which acts, of course, as character masks. But they have to obey the rationality defined in the first chapter. So what you have in the second chapter is the individual behavior within and realizing the macro social foundation. This individual behavior must be realized in money, which is derived in the second chapter of the first edition, thanks to social custom and to the intervention of the state. In the second edition, this appears in a couple of lines already in the first chapter. What is value theory for Heinrich in general? Value theory is the exposition of the successive shapes of the form of social determination of labor. Along the three volumes, it is not a quantitative labor theory of value. It is not really a theory of exploitation. Exploitation has always been there, says Annie. It is the continuity of history. Marx focused on the discontinuity. If you stress exploitation, as I do, you risk being a socialist Ricardian. What is the socialization in generalized exchange and capitalism? I anticipated it at the beginning of my talk. It is an act reglic Vergesellschaft, and a posteriori socialization is nothing but the ex post monetary validation as social of what actually were the private labors of the producers. Through exchange, these private labors are confirmed as part of a coherent, though unplanned, division of production among individual producers. Adorno is there somewhere in the hall, but it's there. Value, says Michael Haneke, actually exists only in exchange and only as a relation between commodities. It does not exist in the individual commodity. The measure of values, also the magnitude of value, the objectification of value happens only in circulation. So abstract labor, like value, are actual entities only in circulation. The real abstraction is consummated by the unconscious behavior of those who exchange only in circulation. As you will see, I agree partially, but not completely, with this point. The only, I stress it because I think there is too much stress on it. After labor, I will try to say, exists in a meaningful meaning also before. I agree, however, with Heinrich in saying that abstract labor is not, as in the tradition of Marxism, just simple labor or unskilled labor or physiological labor or mechanical labor, or as Spinelli would say, what in the Grundrisse said, as labor devoid of content. Heinrich says, this is especially in the second edition, probably reacting to a criticism of Backhaus and Reichelt in a paper 1995, it's only in German unfortunately. Heinrich says, my view of the abstraction of labor cannot be read as a conceptual abstraction. It is not that, a begriffic abstraction. It is the conceptual abstraction is when you equalize, so to speak, the labors or the use values through a thought operation. You are just considering two different things and notices a common attribute. This has nothing to do with what is happening in the reality we have in front of us. The reality in front of us is the real abstraction in some writers' meaning, that is a reale abstraction. An abstraction from the use values of two commodities, which is executed and exists in practice in exchange, no matter what those engaged in the exchange think. So it's not a conceptual abstraction. Note that you find exactly the same phrase, he does not use the term real abstraction, but use the concept. Lucio Poletti, in the papers of 67, 68 on Bersen, where he proposes a new interpretation of the value theory, he says the abstraction of labor is going on in practice in circulation, in the daily reality of circulation. Which is a bit paradoxical because both authors are quoting Marx from the contribution to political economy, but they are substituting circulation to production, but that's another thing altogether. This real abstraction, as I told you, daily going on through the non-conscious behavior of those who exchange, is going on in the exchange of the universal equivalent money at the end, is reacting backwards. So labor is imprinted, of, not only in this retroactive way, of the nature of abstraction. Let us go into the second part, the more critical one. First, I told you before that I very much like Michele Heinrich. He is a philologically rigorous reader of Marx. But this is not something that he does to propose a true homogeneous Marx who is the solution to any problem. He actually problematizes Marxian theory and he wishes to reconstruct Marxian theory. I use here reconstruction in my own meaning. Probably it's not the meaning of Michael Heinrich. In this German literature, probably reconstruction was, we know who the pure Marx was and we reconstruct that pure Marx. For reconstruction, I mean to resolve the ambiguities and ambivalences in Marx. Heinrich very much stresses the ambivalences, the ambiguities, the aporias, the incoherence in Capital. And I completely with him. Where are my dissonance? First, I think that Heinrich breaks with Marx on the monetary theory of value. This is a point which will come back tomorrow, in my lecture tomorrow. In fact, Marx's argument at the beginning of Capital is notoriously not an easy one, but not just because of the Hegelian language of those chapters. The fact is that Marx is pursuing two lines at the same time. The first one is the one which is followed by Heinrich, and it is to see in value and in abstract labor, something which becomes actual only in the unity of production and circulation in a generalized commodity and monetary circulation. This is what Marx is doing, and here Heinrich is very faithful. But at the same time, Marx is doing something which seems to be the opposite, and this is completely cut away by Michael Heinrich, because Marx at the same time is saying that what is behind this unity of production and circulation is that value realized in the value form, value realized in money, is nothing but the outward expression of some gelatin of labor. Gelatin is Gallerte, the term that Marx uses in German, an expression, outward expression of a gelatin of labor, which is already commensurable, which are already commensurable before final commodity exchange. So, behind this unity of production and circulation, without this circularity, if you wish, commodity, there is a linear line which goes from the inner to the outer. Now, in fact, what Michael Heinrich is doing is saying what is there in production before final exchange are only non-homogeneous, non-commensurable use values, non-homogeneous, non-commensurable concrete labels. They become homogeneous and commensurable only in final exchange. So in this way, you end up creating an abyss between the real world of production and the monetary world of circulation. This term, abyss between these two worlds, was the critique which was mounted against Michael Heinrich by Backhaus and Reichelt There it is written 96, it is wrong. The critique of Backhaus and Reichel against Heinrich is of 95. Hmm? But actually, I anticipated this problem in my paper in 99 on the monetary labor theory of value, in which I showed that all the debate of the 70s ended up with this dichotomy between the substantialist and the formalist. So I think here I agree with Backhaus and Reichel against Michael Heinrich. The second of my distance with Heinrich is that Heinrich is breaking with Marx on abstract labor, because in my view Marx is quite clear that Arbeit is labor as activity, and labor as activity is dual, concrete and abstract, already in production. Where Heinrich is right? Heinrich is right in saying that the solidarity between these two arguments, the unity of production and circulation, and the movement from production to circulation, well, it is quite problematical. Does this mean that Marx was completely incoherent in chapter one? Well, actually not. Marx had a coherent theory here. And the coherence of Marx was related to the view that Marx had in Capital that money is essentially a commodity. Let us say gold. So the argument by Marx is that before the actual final exchange, commodities produced have a tag. This tag is the price form. The price form is the money name of the gelatin. It is an ideal money. This already, according to Marx, is a qualitative homogenization. But Marx says it's not only qualitative, it is also a quantitative determination, which is what Heinrich denies. Why? Because Marx says, you can look at the first three chapters and you find easily the quotes, the value of money, which is there implied in the price tag, in the price form, in this money name, this value of money, I, Marx, takes it as given. And why I take it as given? Because it has been already fixed at an originally unmediated exchange of products, when gold as a commodity, not yet money but becoming money, is exchanged at the point of production with the other commodities. Marx is clear, and he writes twice in two different places in the first three chapters that this is an unmittelbaren Produkten Austausch, an unmediated exchange of products, not commodities. Waren Austausch, commodity exchange, is always monetary for Marx. This is not mediated by money, already by money. It is barter. So, in this situation, Marx is saying the concrete labor embodied in gold as a commodity, when it goes into the market, is a private labor. But thanks to this exchange with the other commodities, this private labor in gold becomes the immediately social labor, counts as immediately social labor. So you have that. The abstract labor producing commodities is the private labors organized by the producers, and this private labor organized by the producers is not immediate social labor. The immediate social of labor is only the concrete labor producing money as a commodity. This is important later on to discuss Finelli. So, if I am right in my critique, none of the three conclusions by Heinrich to be accepted. Value does not exist only in situations he says, abstract labor does not exist only in situations as he says. In some sense, value and abstract labor for Marx are there before. But Heinrich also says that money as a commodity is conceptually inessential in Marx's deduction. In interpreting Marx, Heinrich says, yes, Marx believes that money is a commodity, but this is just a mistake which was induced in his mind by the monetary system of his time. It is a contingent element. In my interpretation, it is not a contingent element. It is exactly what makes coherent Marx's labor theory of value, what makes coherent the two movements, because already before the final exchange, already with the price tag, you have the quantitative dimension. So the question is, what price if we abandon the theory of money as a commodity? It seems that the risk is to accept the two world views as Heinrich does, and I don't want to go that way. At the same time, I agree with Heinrich that a good monetary theory cannot be a commodity money theory. So now the ball is my card. That is, I have to show that it is possible to replicate, to reconstruct Marx's argument in its dual dimension, the circularity, unit of production and circulation, and the movement from production to circulation in a non-commodity money setting. Here I skip, though it would be interesting, and maybe Janus could be excited. There is a part in which Heinrich refers to Hegel, to affirms that the universality in money does not need to be a commodity. The particular concrete labor of a commodity really becoming a real universal. He makes a nice, he takes a nice quote from Hegel, in which Hegel says that the animal does not exist. Only the different animals exist. But if you go in the first chapter of Marx's Capital, first edition, you see that Marx is saying exactly the opposite, and I think, wrongly, attributing this opposite conclusion to Hegel himself. And it is where Marx says it is as if, in the monetary exchange of money and commodities, as if beside lions, tigers, hares, and all other real animals, also the animal existed, the individual incarnation of the whole animal kingdom. But I have not time to go into. Let be quicker. Let us look at somebody who was there on this kind of problematic before Coletti, before Adorno, before Backhaus, before Lacan. He was Isaac Ilich Rubin. In his essays on Marx's value theory, there are four editions of it. It is quoted by Heinrich saying, oh, he was a nice guy, very, very fine interpreter, but not resolving the issue. It's funny because Heinrich quotes Rubin as 24. I don't think he has read Rubin 24. Rubin had the first edition in 23, the Essays of Marx like the theory. A second edition with some small additions in 24. These are in Russia. There was a huge debate against Rubin and with people to, on the side of Rubin in Russia. Rubin answered to this criticism in 27 and very much changed some chapters in 28, the third edition. The third edition is what we have. There is an English translation of the third edition of 72-73. So after Coletti, after Reichelt, after the first writings of Backhaus, Backhaus later said, oh yes, somebody told me to read Rubin, and yes, it was there already before me, but I didn't read it. And I didn't, even now, I have not read all the book. This third edition is very different from the second edition. The translation, by the way, is incomplete. It misses a long introduction and two long appendixes against the critics. All the translations are borrowed from the translation in US. Nobody went to there to translate from the Russian, except one Japanese scholar, Susumu Takenaga. Why? Because Susumu Takenaga had the occasion to see that there was a fourth edition in 29, just a few lines more in the preface, plus another appendix against another critic. Now, the third and fourth edition are quite different from the second edition. And what is funny is that the way Rubin is pictured and the same position of Heinrich are very similar to what we know was the position of Rubin in the second edition. In the second edition, Rubin stressed the dominance of circulation over production. It is called in the West the Rubinite position. It is the position of the Rubinite, but not of Rubin. Dominance of circulation over production as distinct moments in the secret. And in that edition, Rubin isolated conceptually after labor in final commodity situation after production. He was criticized by others. If we want to understand Rubin, we should mix three debates. This one on labor theory of value, the one on dialectics versus the mechanicists in Russia, the third one was on planning. I can't go into the details of how the three positions were interlocked and Rubin intervened on all three. What is sure is that in the paper in 27, which has been translated before in German and then in English, he said, oh, I have been misunderstood. I have been not clear. So now I propose you the true position, and the true position is that we have to distinguish exchange as a separate moment of circulation and exchange as the form of the social process of total reproduction. So here, production is production for exchange as the social totality. And Rubin was quite clear about the unity of circulation and production. But in my view, he was already hinting in the 27 paper and here and there in the book, though it would not be so clear, probably, on what I said before about value as form, as ideal money in the price form, and the form of value as exchange value, that is, as money, as real money in exchange. Now, he wrote almost a book, it is unfinished, Essays on Marx Money Theory. It has been found in his papers. It has been published in Russia in 2011, translated in German in 2012, and the next year, it will, next month, he should be out in English. Since I was writing an entry on Rubin, and I knew of this forthcoming collection in which Rubin was included, at this point I looked for the editors, I looked for them, they didn't send me all the papers they are translating, but they sent me the two crucial ones. One is this book. And from my point of view, I'm happy and a bit unhappy. From my point of view, these essays on my theory are fully confirming, or almost fully confirming, my reading of Marx. Why am I unhappy? Because it's very often, sometimes I think I have an original position, and it turns out that somebody edited it before me, or even better than me. Hmm? These are two quotes from Rubin, but I have not the time to go there. This is Rubin, the doubling of the form. And so, let me move to Claudio Napoloni. So, the important thing of Rubin for me is that he saw the dual movement I'm stressing. Unitary production, circulation, and going from production to circulation at the same time. Circularity and linearity. The same was true of Claudio Napoloni. I studied with him, I became a Marxian for him. I'm reading seriously Capital because I met him and it is 43 years now. He changed very much in his life. I took him when he had a really serious Marxian reading. Problematical as the one by Rubin. He was not something saying there are no problems. So, a lot of open problems. But he wanted to have together the philosophical side of Marx and the side of Marx as an economist. I stress here two points in his interpretation of these years. One is Smith Ricardo Marx, the second edition in Italian, 73, translated in English in 75. This book existed in the first edition, 70, but it was the other Napoleone. The book had an introduction, a chapter on physiocrats, a chapter on Smith, a chapter on Ricardo, and some chapters on Marx. But he changed completely his mind on Marx in 71, 72. So, what he did, he published a second edition with a new introduction and a new fundamental chapter on Marx. In that chapter, one of the things he says is that there is an ambiguity in Marx's deduction of abstract labor. On one side, the first chapters of Capital, abstract labor is dialectically derivated from exchange as such. But there was private labor which has to become social in final commodity equation. But there was another clear definition of abstract labor as abstract labor in the Grundrisse. You have in the Grundrisse a section where Marx says that abstract labor is the living labor of the wage workers as opposed to capital. Then Marx says, oh, two definitions, ambiguity. But is we got this ambiguity? No, it is only apparent because exchange for Marx is universalized only with capital. I told you that this is a position of the most sensible interpreters of Marx in my view, including Heigel, etc. So, when we are reading the first section of Capital, we must know that we are talking of fully developed capitalism. We don't have yet the categorical construction to speak of capital, but the object is fully developed capitalism. But Napoloni says, if we take my line of interpretation, we have one thing to explain. When Marx speaks of the private individuals whose labors are socially equated through commodity exchange, what are these private individuals? And the answers The private individuals, is Marx is talking about, is the individual labors of the single workers, which are brought together in collective workers, capitalist firms, which are separated in competition against one another. So, in the essence of capital, what Napoleon is saying, you have not only capital as a whole, you don't only have capital abstracted to competition, from competition. You have also many capitals in competition, one with the other. Labor theory of value means labors which must be connected together in exchange, and these are the capitalist first, the many capitals in competition. So you can't avoid competition altogether. And that's what happens in the first book of Capital. Go to chapter 10 in the fourth edition, 13, if I remember well, or 12, in the third German edition, and you have the fact that Marx, to explain relative surplus value extraction, must put in competition already in book one. The second point, which is important, and it's useful for the argument about Fergus and Schaffner, socialization, is of this book he published in 76. You know, I was a student. I spent all my life criticizing my master. Right? My first paper, 79, was a critique of Napoleon. And I spent all the life doing this. I know the guy maybe too much. But when I spoke about a truly Marxian period, I am talking of a period from mid-71 to 75. Then he went in the depression. He didn't publish much in 75. He ended up with this book written in 1 month, I never discovered, Value 76, which is a very good book, but it is already a way out from the Marxian position. Napoleone was connected with Lucio Colletti. Lucio Colletti in 74 declared that there was a contradiction between Marx the philosopher and Marx the economist, the scientist, that Marx the scientist, the follower of political economy, was good. The philosopher, unfortunately, he Colletti realized was a alien. But he knew that in 1769. However, whatever it is, he said, there is this duality, it is an opposition, what do we do? And in the end, in a couple of years, he went out of Marxism, and he ended 20 years later, as a senator for Berlusconi. What Napoleone did in 76? Napoleone always needed a theoretical ally. I have probably this defect too. So, his first reaction was to say, yes, Colletti is right, but it is the opposite. Marx, the philosopher, was right. Marx, the scientist, the economist, was wrong. Unfortunately, value theory as economic theory, as a theory of surplus value, does not work as an economic theory. It is wonderful as a theory of alienation. Then he went into the Marcuse of the early 30s. Then from the Marcuse of the early 30s went to the master of the Marcuse of the early 30s, Heidegger, and it ended with St. Thomas. I didn't went that way. You know, I stayed with the master of the early 70s. In value, however, even though it is kind of this compromise situation, he has a couple of pages which I find really illuminating. He says, with the real substitution of labor to capital, Marx is showing that the technical material reality itself, including labor, is capitalistically formed German. At that point, I'm quoting here from Napoleone, labor as activity not only counts, guilt is in German, as abstract social labor through the mediation of money. What we see at the beginning of Capital First Rejectors. At that point, abstract labor production actually is abstract in the immediate process of production itself. Why? Not because, as Marx hints in the groupings, unfortunately, it is mechanical labor, devoid of content, without art. No, because the concrete properties, Eigenschaften, comes to the workers from outside, from the capitalist manipulation of labor. What is the problem of Rubin and Napoleon? They help to give bones and blood to my idea. There are these two lines in Marx: unit of production and circulation, and from production to circulation. But they don't resolve the difficulty that rightly Heinrich sees in Marx. And why, when they wrote in 27, 28, Rubin in 73, 74, Napoleon, why they didn't see the problem? Because they were actually following, and I can give you references, money, the money as a commodity view of Marx. If money as a commodity goes out, the risk of the abyss between the two dimensions goes out. Well, in this abyss, Roberto Finelli, my friend from Rome, is taking a kind of specular, opposite, negative position than Heinrich. Heinrich is all in circulation, so to speak. Finelli is all in production. Finelli, he uses the Grundrisse quote, the devoid of content, unskilled, too simple labor, part of the quote of Marx. And he says, abstract labor is wage labor, and it is labor which is immediately social in production. For Finelli, abstract labor is already homogeneous and undifferentiated in production. The market, Finelli says, is where commodities, which are already social from the start, the commodities, are related to each other. So, in fact, commodities are produced by a labor which is already social from the beginning. As I told you, Finelli's definition of abstract labor is the photographic negative of Heinrich's. He never speaks of money, he's very confused when he speaks of money. I think that as an interpretation of Marx, let me be frank, it is a disaster. It does not stand up scrutiny. You take Heinrich, you take Finelli, Heinrich is right as a leader of Marx. Finelli is wrong. At the same time, there is a basic confusion, in my view, in the argument of Finelli on some basic categories. Once one understands the basic confusion, one sees the way out from the confusion. Finelli collapses into one, social labor, immediately social labor, and socialized labor. Social labor in Marx is gesellschaftliche Arbeit, and it is the ex post validated labor on the commodity market through money. So, social labor is related to immediately private labors to be exchanged. Immediately social labor, unmittelbare gesellschaftliche Arbeit, is what I told you before. In Marx, the immediate social labor is only one, and it is a concrete labor. It is the concrete labor embodied in money as a commodity. So there are the abstract labor in the commodities, which have to be mirrored by the concrete labor producing money as a commodity. Those are the abstract labor, they are mirrored in the concrete labor producing money as a commodity. Then there is, again, socialized labor, vergesellschaftete Arbeit. Let's go more into detail of vergesellschaftete Arbeit. Marx used this notion not only to characterize Engels in section 4 of chapter 1, the one on fetishism, the common labor in pre-capitalistic forms of society. The other was a socialized labor, says Marx. To characterize the labor in the household, there is a socialized labor. Or Marx uses there, Vergesellschaft der Arbeit, also for communism, the society of freely associated producers. This is what has in mind Heinrich when he speaks of socialized labor. But if you go on in Capital, you see that this Vergesellschaft der Arbeit reappears in a new meaning. Let me open a parenthesis. This is typical of Marx. His categories changes according to the development of the argument at different layers of abstraction. Marx, especially with the real assumption related to capital, uses socialization to refer to how labor necessarily becomes collective and common in capitalist workplaces at the stage of modern industry. Yes, there is a social division of labor between different producers, capitalist firms exchanging on the market. And yes, their labor has to be yet validated as social in final exchange. So these are private labors too, which have to become social in final exchange. But at the same time, in immediate production, they are already immediately socialized. This means that they are socialized because individual single workers do not produce anything alone. One of the merits of Finelli, even though I give a different interpretation than Finelli, is to use the thinking of a common friend, Guido Frison. I think he taught in the high school, but he has done since decades serious works on technology in different theories. He insists on the fact that in Marx there is a specific notion of technology, technologie, and that this notion has to be distinguished from the notion of technique. So our problem is to understand what technology means, what technique means, and what organization means. Technology comes from Cameralism, Beckman, okay. It was what? The technological description of production from the point of view of the rulers of the process. For Cameralism, they were the political leaders, say. But for Marx, it couldn't be that. Who were the rulers of the process? The capitalists. The capitalists are character masks of capital. Technology defines the potential relationship between labor and its means. It is the design of the labor process, treating human beings as things among things. A purely objective picture of production. This is, of course, a naturalistic perspective. It is the point of view of capital as a fetish. And of course, it is presented as something which is natural, but it's not natural, it's historical. It is designed by the capitalism. Then there is the technique. Technique is the relations between the labor power of the workers and the means of labor, a relation which is prescribed in the capitalist labor process. It is the prescription of use of the means of labor by the labor power. Because this potentiality must find reality. What is organization, organizational labor? The fact that capital, to socialize labor in the collective worker, must put in relation workers with other workers in the same places, under the same capitalism. We may discuss how this is changing nowadays. So, I'm quoting from Frison, technology is a potential need which becomes a probable reality thanks to the conflict between labor power and entrepreneur and to the competition between entrepreneurs. Finelli takes this, cancel the potential from the definition of technology, and technology becomes the what imprints workers in production as abstract labor, as socialized labor. Now, let us move to a possible way out from the difficulty to which we are in. The two persons in the photos are, on the left, Suzanne de Brunhoff, who died a few years ago, and on the right-hand side, Augusto Graziani. Augusto Graziani was an Italian economist. I had three masters, so to speak. One was Napoleone, another was Augusto Graziani, the third was Ivan Minsky. They probably would disagree with me on this and that, and Graziani was a very different kind of person than Napoleone, so to speak. Napoleone was at his home speaking of abstract labor and Hegel and all that. Not so Graziani. Why I put them together? Because I think that the two notions of Ferges and Shafton, the two notions of socialization, socialization as an exposed monetary validation of the market, and socialization as something going on potentially in production, can be seen as not contradictory if we put into the argument a prior socialization, which is a monetary socialization, but not like Heinrich's and most Marxists, a socialization of private labors to universal equivalent on final commodity circulations. This was what Marx did in the first three chapters. But in the first three chapters, he assumed that commodities had already been produced. From the fifth chapter onwards, in Capital 101, commodities had to be produced. And in the monetary production economy, to produce commodities, you need to finance this production through money. De Brunhoff calls this financing of production ante-validation as pseudo-validation. She discovered this concept not really in his book on Marx on Money, became crucial after the inflationary crisis of the early 70s. So, the crisis, the period of the oil crisis and the couple of years before. Graziani, like de Brunhoff, has the idea that production process must be ante-validated through money. But in a stronger meaning, for Graziani, the initial finance of the advanced money capital is not really geld after universal wealth, which is the product of capital. It is currency, münze, standing for money. So it is a vanishing means of circulation, which stands for money, and it is bank credit, which is essentially non-commodity money, which goes to buy for capital as a whole what capital as a whole do not possess. Capital as a whole is the labor. Capital as a whole has all the means of production. Capital as a whole does not have in its body the human living, which are the bearers of labor power, and which may spend living labor. I am translating in a Marxian terminology something which the saying is much weaker. So, in fact, total capital at the macro level has to buy only one thing. And this is the story Marx tells in this section on reproduction in the first book of Capital. They have to buy labor power from the working class. So that's the only thing they have to buy, and they do that anticipating this finance to production, and this anticipation is a monetary socialization of labor power. It is an ex-ante monetary printing of labor power. Because of that, capitals may treat labor power in the production processes as something that can be manipulated. So, I am setting the Marx monetary value theory into a larger perspective, which is what I call the macro monetary theory of surplus value, the macro monetary labor theory of surplus value. I am talking of the cycle of money capital. The cycle of money capital, you know, it is money, commodity, more money. This is the formula of capital in book one. In the second book, it becomes money, buying, means of production, and labor power, but at the aggregate, the means of production disappear. The labor power goes into the productive process, living labor, producing the commodities, which are sold, which are expected to be sold on the market, and then maybe sold. This is the cycle of money capital in book two. It becomes the cycle of the interesting building capital in volume three. How to read this cycle outside a money as a commodity perspective? Yes, Graziani says, it is the banking system which finance capitalist firms. And that banking system finance is no commodity finance. It is just science. But Graziani does not go into the way of the formalist, of the only monetary perspectives. Graziani says, but look, this initial advanced money capital has a labor contract. What is the labor contract? It is the real wage of the working class, which is nothing but the labor contained in the real wage of the working class. Then workers produce, there is the production of an output. This output has a price for ideal money to become real money. I do a step more than Graziani, maybe he could agree here, I don't know. And I say, but look, actually, if you look at what Marx does in Capital, and there is a confirmation in chapter 10 of the third book, Marx is thinking that yes, capitalists go to sell their commodities on the market. They may sell them, they may not sell them. But actually, capitalists are producing for the expected demand. So expected demand is driving production. This is something which was very clear in Rosa Luxemburg, especially in the introduction to political economy. So, what may happen is that, yes, capitalism at a certain point becomes very pessimist and the economy goes into crisis. Or banks decide not to finance the capitalists and so the building collapses. But, in fact, when we are analyzing the production process of capitalists, they are hiring and exploiting workers, and their abstract labor will be entirely actualized on the market. This does not mean that there is no crisis. This means that just the short run, so to speak, variations are cancelled. It is what Keynes does in the general theory. He says, let us imagine the most abstract level of the argument, that the short-term expectations of firms are fully realized. So, in my reading, abstract labor becomes a processual category. It begins as the labor power, which is potential abstract labor, which is ex ante socialized through finance to production. It becomes abstract labor in becoming, the socialization in production, to be sold according to expectation, and then it ends up as the abstract labor fully realized, as the value completely coming into being, in monetary circulation. There is a point in Backhaus and Reichelt critique of Hayek, which is very intriguing for me, because in the first part they are reading and criticizing Hayek, and the argument follows very easily, and I think it can be read without problems. In the second part, they are finding a solution, because they share the difficulty of Hayek. And there, among the many conflicting lines that they are presenting, there is this one which seems to me to be the main thread. And it is this argument, and so we are back at the beginning, so back at the end. Value, they say, what is value? It is an objective objectuality. Please go back to the Adorno's part of the argument. It is an objectivitet which has been objectualized, so to speak. It is front of us. But this value cannot be grasped as an object in the individual commodity. We cannot handle it materially. And then what is this value, which is nothing but the pre-monetary value of Backhaus? It is circulating capital. Don't be fooled by the term circulating. It is not, they are not speaking of circulating capital in an economic term. It is value and money and capital which circulates in a spiral. It is the super individual subject which is over grasping and dominating, chapter 4, the beginning of chapter 4 of Capital Volume 1, Marx speaks of Übergreifendes Subjekt. It is a subject which is guised, exactly. It is the quote of Reichelt and Colletti, in which guised is equal to capital or Marx. This subject is overgrasping all the moments, but is also imposing itself to all the moments. And this value, this objective objectuality, which cannot be grasped as an object, this is a very strange reality, exists only in the permanent changing of forms of value. That would be very nice to go into, but I can't go into the details, so three slides in three phrases. I think that to go out from the cars of the Neue Marxist Theorie, one has to realize that the transition from money to money as capital is not a dialectical derivation. Here there is a break of Marxism. If we go first chapter, second chapter, third chapter, the fourth chapter, on the overriding, overgrasping, that can be read as the homology between capital and Geist. But then Marx asks how this subject is constituted. And this question of the constitution is not answered through the line Adorno, Reichelt, Backhaus, focusing only on exchange and modern exchange. He goes into what is in Italian, for German edition, the second section on the fifth chapter, the one on the valorization process. In English, it's the second section of the seventh chapter. And what Marx shows there is that to pass from money as money to to manage capital, capital has to win what Balibar calls class struggle in production. Workers must be compelled to work. This compulsion is exerted by capital and it cannot be taken for granted. Why? Because labor power is attached to the workers as human bearers of labor power. So when capital buys labor power is of capital. Labor power, living labor, the use of labor power, is of capital. But at the same time, labor power is attached to the workers, and those who work are the workers. Here there is a specificity and a difficulty, a social specific difficulty of capital. Capital is forced labor, labor forced on free and equal subjects, an historical novelty. And Marx says that in the theory of surplus value. Though the existence of surplus labor presupposes that the productivity of labor has reached a certain level, the mere possibility of the surplus labor, that is, the existence of a necessary minimum productivity of labor, does not in itself make it a reality. You cannot take it for granted. For this to occur, the laborer must first be compelled to work beyond the limits of necessary labor. And this compulsion is exerted by capital. So, to go from money to money, to, from money as money, to money as capital, means to move from money as a chrysalis, which is there, and the chrysalis becomes a butterfly, capital. For this to happen, Marx says, the cost of value in the individual commodity must become capital as a vampire, capital which takes human beings, puts them into the automatic monster, and exploits them. Let us close with Adorno on the ancillaries. I refer to Bacaus quoting Adorno implicitly on ancillarism. So I was curious and said, oh, let us go and look where Adorno speaks of ancillarism. And these are some quotes. This is from Late Capitalism or Industrial Society, question mark. Adorno says, the totality, or in Hegel's words, the all-penetrating ether of society, is anything but ethereal. You know, Heinrichs has been accused, but I think he would accept that and say that this definition of value is ethereal. Here Adorno says that the totality is anything but ethereal. On the contrary, it enhances realism, the scholastic category. Insofar as it is absolutely vain, the fault of its abstraction is not to be blamed on a solipsistic and reality distant thinking. It is not a fault of thinking. But on the exchange relationship, the objective abstractions, you know, what Adorno thinks of exchange, belongs to the social life process. The power of that abstraction over humanity, which seems ethereal, in fact, it is far more corporeal than that of any single institution, which silently constitutes itself in advance according to the schemes of things and fits itself into human beings. What is ancillarism? Scholastic category. Ancillarism is actually the ultimate real entity. It is God. You go to and read Kant's Critique of Pure Reason and you refer to the ancillarism and read it as the supreme and complete material condition of the possibility of all that exists. Then Kant says, if we take this all that exists and make it a subject with the capital S, hypostasize, all that exists, well, we yield, Kant says, the ens realissimo, something which is personified, which looks like God. Well, I think that Adorno was thinking of something like that and refers to this again and again, not only in negative dialectics, also in three studies on Hegel, also in non-Zone literature. In non-Zone literature, I think in an essay on Balzac, he is referring to Brecht. The two were not exactly on the same line. But he says, Brecht, and this is an appreciation, so that the ens realismum consists of processes, not immediate facts, and cannot be depicted as such. Let us go back to the true Bacchus. Bacchus says, premonitory value as such cannot be realized in a planetary, in a premonitory exchange value. This is what Ricardians do, that Ricardians do, neo-Ricardians do, these Ruffians, neoclassicals do. No, it is not this. But Bacchus says, in its own specific premonitory character, premonitory value of Mars is the most real. This absolute value is the ens realissimum in Adorno's meaning. Think of the other quotes. The engine of a dialectical development, the principle that in the last instance is realized only in the movement of capital's world market. In the Bacchus and Reichelt critique of Heinrich, they say it we have an inner, which is a movement of thinking, a Gedankenbewegung, which is becoming, it is a process, an object, and it is externalized in exchange value. Externalized is a Teusserung, is like somebody who divests himself or herself of the body, which is transmigrated, incarnated, in another body. Standing in front of commodities as a universal that exists. Colletti, in lectures of the early 70s, before becoming scared that he was an Hegelian, he wrote on something very similar line, and he says, we don't need to have a naive and superficial notion of metaphysics, as if metaphysical things do not exist. And what Adorno and Reichelt and Bacchus are saying, this metaphysical thing, which is a ghost, absolute value, in fact exists. The inner, that's my interpretation, that's my development beyond the course of the Neumann's lecture, is that this inner finds its incarnation in capitalist technology, in capitalist migration of labor, something which is continuously fractured and pushed by capitalist competition, by the social conflict, by the class antagonism, and needs to be continuously reaffirmed. Even when workers are oppressed, there is still the possibility they could not be oppressed. This is the web page that I have with my partner, where you find news of what we do. I spoke my 2 hours.
Yes, thank you very much.
We have 20 minutes we want to discuss.
So let's start then.
Contestation.
So, maybe
about it that
presentare a Electric must appear and don't talk about difference between translations, semblance, appearance, and so on. And this is Hegelian structure. He starts
value is as if appearance of saying good night. All the following interventions, questions?
Yes, just a short one. So, thank you for a very interesting lecture. I really like the development of the nightmare structure. I found it a lot more convincing than the description of the first chapters that, as they are described by Heinrich and the likes. And just one thing, because on the one side you talked about how the abstract value is constituted first in the money as a boolean, as gold, for example.
Yes. The subject was how.
So no, it's not a big question, but yes, but you talked about the value coming.
Yes.
Abstract value coming first from money as gold, for example, as the first bearer of the abstract value and abstract labor. And then in your solution of the problem how abstract labor is constituted, you constructed this circle, but I assume you want to describe the world of fiat money as well.
Yes.
So how does it change the picture, and how does it relate to what Marx says about the constitution of abstract labor in money as he describes it, and as Heinrich doesn't mention this point?
Now we need this. How to clean
the board?
The board.
Give me a second, I will do it.
Thank you. I distinguish interpretation and reconstruction. Further is the reading. In the reading, you are in a chaotic dimension, so that's not interpretation. You have a lot of ambiguities. Interpretation tries to understand the author at the best of himself or herself, so to speak. My interpretation leads to the idea that there are serious problematic points that needs to be overcome. I do that not only saying, you know, in Marx, value theory, there are unexploited richness. I also think that Marx's value theory must be confronted with more contemporary developments. So, as Marx did a critique of political economy, he took from Ricardo, and he said that Ricardo was all wrong, right? He took from Ricardo certain points, and then provided the critique. So I think that after the 20th century, we need to take stock of the new political economy, because in my perspective, there has been a political economy in the 20th century. It didn't end in 1830, as the usual story goes. And the most interesting new political economy was the monetary line, especially the monetary macro. It's a long line. The names are, paradoxically enough, a neoclassical theorist, Wicksell, which is his money theory was very much heterodox, Schumpeter, and Keynes, not the Keynes of general theory, the Keynes before the general theory in the treatise of money. What I'm doing is interpreting Marx saying, look, he was less incoherent than it is usually thought, because a lot of these incoherences were overcome within the perspective of money as a commodity. But if, as I think we should do not have to believe in the theory of money as a commodity, though I avoid to say that this 9 is 100% wrong, because there is a moment in which it is not wrong. The general universal crisis in the market, you know,
It's not strictly speaking right, but you know, it's not so false. But in general, to reconstruct the capitalist process, you need to have a non-commodity theorem. So, I say, from the point of reconstruction, Marx is not so incoherent if he has minus a commodity. From the point of view of interpretation, sorry, no? It's not so incoherent. But from the point of view of reconstruction, we must go towards a macro approach. What I'm doing is actually this. This is the advanced money capital, which in the cycle of money capital, Kreislauf, at the beginning of the Second World, goes to buy means of production and labor power. They go into production, of course this could be P in the traditional, where we have labor. Labor power and living labor are internally related in the figure of the living labor power bearers, the workers. Living labor produce commodities. This, of course, where we first see. These commodities have a price tag and must be realized in money. Now, Marx's original argument was, as I told you, he began from here, actually. This, you have the price tag, which had a labor content, but this could be then applied to any monetary quantity. So when he goes beyond the first three chapters, what he has is this kind of cycle, actually. In the first book, it's just M, C, and prime, but it's the same. And so what he has is a given amount of money, which is gold, but it's also labor, a given amount of money, labor. So money is a commodity perspective. What happens, in my view, is that this is advanced by banks. So actually, I should move towards the third book dimension, interest-bearing capital. And rather than speaking of interest-bearing capital, speaking specifically of the section, which is the financial capital as banking capital. So the bankers anticipate sign money here. That's financing to production. This financing to production gives way to production and gives way to consumption plus investment, monetary magnitudes. Investments are within the capitalist class. The capitalist class advances 100 money. They get only 100 money, because this is the money which bill, this is the consumption goods bought by the workers. Now, for simplicity, I assume that they would spend all the money and they do not save. Right? It would be more complicated, but we could arrive to a similar result without this. So one says, oh, but this is not mass, MC and prime. Remember the distinction between money and currency. This is bank finance as currency, muse, which circulates. In the end, the abstract wealth produced was more. And actually, the abstract wealth for the capitalist is what? Capital is potential capital. So the abstract wealth is this, in a sense, the new means of production, which are capital as long as they are future capital for future exploitation. If capitalist thinks that this future exploitation may go well, okay, they invest. If they think it is not, the process is blocked. This is all in non-commodity my interest. But what is this? This is what regulates this finance to production. The real wage of the working class. That is, capitalists produce a certain amount of goods, thanks to the new living labor. To produce them, they need to reproduce the working class. The living labor power bearers. So a part of production goes to them. This part of production is what? Is the real wage of the working class. What remains to them and does not go to capitalists, rentier, etc. So this is a macro perspective. Real wage for the working class. This is a value market. It's labor contained in this real wage. Then Marx says, oh, but workers may save, etc. Totally irrelevant for the class. They can only take hold of those goods. The individual worker may save and smooth his consumption over time. But if the capitalist, if this working class decides immediately to translate the savings into goods, and the goods are not there, what happens to them? So this is actually the only true cost in value for the capitalist class. And this has to do with labor power. This is the value of labor power. Finance of production is the money sign, the money name of the value of labor power at the class dimension. Then you have living labor. Then you have what is produced. What is produced is objectified labor. Is the living labor which has been objectified. As objectified labor, it is a given amount of labor, hoping that it will be realized. At this moment, we have no certainty about that. This is here ideal money, sometime here. Then, once it is sold, it is real money. So to speak, this is my abstract labor to be realized. And this is the abstract labor which actually was realized, so the immediately social labor. Value, money. This is money in motion, value in motion. This, of course, is using Marx's ways of using Hegel, a moment of forestellum here. It is expected, it is notional, who knows. Now what I'm saying is, look, Marx, when he looks at this cycle, he stresses the uncertainties that the rest of economic theory this time was not looking at. He stresses first the uncertainty here in the first chapter. Will commodities be sold? Who knows? They must reveal themselves as used value for others. And of course, it will be the themes of the Keynesians, so to speak. Here we may put another uncertainty. Marx talks about it, but also transparently more probably in volume 3. Here the uncertainty is, will I as an industrial capitalist receive finance from banks? Will Hayek's bank do well giving money to this capital? And this, let us say, it is the Schumpeterian problematic, the financing of the entrepreneur, the innovation, whatever. Of course, Marx says these two things, and as I think that nobody else has, in my view. Because in my view, he has the fact that the translation of living, of labor power in living labor, cannot be completely granted. I constructed a huge building to say there is a fetish and there is the human constitution of the fetish. But the human constitution of the fetish has to do with class struggle and production. Fetish has to do with value, money, capital, technology, the organization of labor, etc. Both are there. I can't do the Negri, Tronti thing, only the second which pushes the first. Nor can sell the subjective element in the objective one. And when I do my writings on material crisis, I try to pursue the relations between the two. So this is, let us say, my way of finding a way out. Now, a very quick answer to him, because we are all tired. I'm not sure I understood completely what you were saying, but I am a pure economist, and I don't even want to be an economist. I wanted to study story and philosophy. Then I decided to do law because my father insisted in doing law. And it was late 60s, early 70s. Okay, after I do political science. Then, you know, I was politically involved. I met Napoleon. This is what I want to do. There was also a kind of male chauvinist argument that I think was there for some of my generation. If you think that the whole, the social totality, has class social relations in production at the center, and you become the expert of the center, you are the center of the center. However, I decided to move from law to political economy and the critique of political economy. But this story means that I am ignorant and I didn't want to go into Hegel. And if somebody says that's simple, it's a simple Hegel, perfect if it works. I need the minimum for my argument. I started to complicate I hope not the solution in my mind, but the reconstruction of the Marx-Hegel relationship somehow by chance, somehow because forced by groups. I was in an intellectual group in the International Symposium on Marx and Theory. They were mostly stressing Marx and Hegel. I knew some, but okay. They were only discussing the first three chapters. So I said, I want to know better than them, and find a way out. A group of students asked to me in 2004 to run a capital reading group, so I said, okay. They wanted a slow reading. It took 10 years for the old book, 3 years for the first one. And they used them to force me to confront all the translations, the first book, with the original German. Maybe I'm wrong, but I realized that there are serious errors in any translation. So if you want to go and look and check what I'm saying, you have to look at the translation, but look at the original. Because, for example, all the game I did about socialization, you go into the collected writings of Marx in English, they translate Vergesellschaftete and the real substantial of labor not as socialization but as common, collective, so you don't get the same word, and this puts you at a question. But then I did this online, there is a 14 lectures in Turin, this is 2014, 2015. In which I read the oral category. So I tried to look at how the categories were
I must confess that probably the problematic, I know unfortunately that my master don't change radically. So I changed a bit of my interpretation, but probably not the general line. The general line is to put together the argument about the French constitution, about money and labor. So I think the traditional Marxism was weak on both, but for sure the economic theory of the Marxists is weak on money. And those who take seriously money abandon labor. That's not what they want to do, because probably they like the way we were, you know. So when I read and read people like Arthur Schmidt of those years, I feel at home, you know. So that's the point. They are categories that I recognize, but I think that the problematic must be dealt at this depth of reading on Marx. So it is true in a sense that we are now, every time we begin reading Marx once more. But, you know, we are in a possibility which was not there for the great tradition of Marxism until the 50s, early 60s, of understanding the development of Marx beyond, the logical development of Marx beyond what is there in the published writings, more or less the same.